Speaker, I am in support of Budget 2022, which lays the foundation and establishes a framework through which the development of our country can move forward. 2022 budget is designed to enhance the welfare of all Guyanese. Budget 22 creates the linkages between our people and citizens and the transformation of our country. Mr. Speaker, I want to reflect a minute. I have listened from Monday to today. Today is probably some of the worst things we've heard in this parliament. And I have to ground myself and think in a different way. We have to remind ourselves as Guyanese of how blessed we are. That we're blessed with many diverse resources that few countries in the world have. That we have a landmass the size of the UK. That we have bauxite, gold, diamonds, uranium, manganese, and many others not discovered as yet. We have fertile land, agriculture, not just on the coast, with the potential for agro-processing, shade farming, and a range of productions in the agricultural area. We have fisheries, ocean, river, and agriculture. We have water. Many countries don't and do not have supplies of water. We have forest, timber. We have the potential for VAT wood production. And we have undiscovered and untapped scientific potential for the rainforest products. We have an intact rainforest of one of the six left in the world. Our most important asset, our people, the diversity of the ethnicity of our people. We are a country of minorities. All of us are minorities. None of us, not one ethnic group comprises 50% of the population. We are a country of diverse religions and 9 indigenous languages. We have cultural artists, musicians, and craftsmen. And we have one of the most progressive legislations in the entire world with regard to the ownership of Amerindian or indigenous peoples' land titling. And so, when you listen in this house, you wonder, do we not remember this? Do we not? And this is what, when our government and our president is talking about one Guyana, it is recognizing and celebrating the oneness as a nation, our diversity. Mr. Speaker, I have to remind us about how blessed we are after listening to the speeches on the other side that threaten to drag us into the abyss of division, nothingness, and no future, just as the same as the last 65 years. I had to remind us as Guyana now stands on the cusp of an opportunity to propel ourselves forward, to reach our dreams of a modern, democratic, developed nation. Or are we to be held back in a vicious whirlpool of nauseating small-mindedness, intolerance, division, and hopelessness? The choice is clear. And in this house, we see the two views, unlike sun and the moon. We refuse to be dragged into a nauseating, small-minded whirlpool of nihilism. After 56 years of nationhood, Mr. Speaker, finally, after the violence of the 1960s, the repeated rigged elections from 1968 to 85, the years of indebtedness and IMF economic recovery program, and the conditions of the HIPC, the onerous debt repayments accumulated pre-1992, poverty and geographic disparities, the 2020 March general and regional elections demonstrated in the face of extreme corruption and a threat to our democracy, that the Guyanese people wanted democracy first and foremost. They wanted to choose the government of their choice and exhibited a level of maturity and resilience to ensure that this right was guarded, that democracy prevailed. Mr. Speaker, despite extreme provocation by election officials and senior officials in the former government, we remained resilient as a people. And I speak for all, whether they supported APNU AFC, the voters that supported APNU AFC, or the voters who supported us. And it is noteworthy that many of those who were involved in the most terrible crime of all The worst crime of corruption is in attempting to steal the people's votes and to reverse democracy, to reverse the will of the people, of a nation, of an entire nation. And you're telling us here sanctimoniously about corruption. Seriously. Ghana, you know, wasn't alone, Mr. Speaker. The PPC and the democratic forces of this country were not alone in those 5 months. The world stood in defense and support. No matter what some opposition members have said in this House that they won, the world knows otherwise. They continue to be delusional. They continue to be isolated. Continue to be isolated from reality. Mr. Speaker, APNU AFC has no moral compass. It is delusional, it is amoral, and it has no conscience to come to this House and to say the things that have been said in this House. One speaker says, just a few moments ago, that Ghana is an undemocratic, oppressive, petroleum dictatorship. Well, Mr. Speaker, I think the member was looking in the mirror, and therefore what he saw was not their PPPC, but the reflection of the APNU AFC when it was in government. Mr. Speaker, we have heard another speaker just before me talking about virtual apartheid. Virtual apartheid. We say corruption is not allowed in this House, but apartheid should not be allowed in this House. Because you know why? Apartheid is the institutional racial segregation of people. And that is what that member is saying in this House. And we sit here and accept it. This is what is acceptable for those of us who fought in the anti-apartheid movement long years ago. This sticks like a dagger in your throat, sir. To call this country, the PPPC, virtual apartheid to do with education, online education, when the person who spoke was in charge of the telecommunications sector of this country, who had 100 ICT hubs built and ready to be connected and did nothing, who cannot answer for where much of the money is gone. And you know, Mr. Speaker, we shouldn't be surprised that she said that, really. Because the honourable member has a penchant, as a friend of mine says, to say these kind of catchphrases. But she's also reflecting the former leader of the opposition, pre-2015, who spoke about education apartheid. Education apartheid. So this is now the new catchphrase, the issue of race and corruption. But Mr. Speaker, finally, we can breathe. We have come out of 2020 August and we can breathe. Finally, after 5 years, we can work as a nation to build a new Guyana, a one Guyana built on inclusivity, participation, transparency, accountability, and the rule of law. Mr. Speaker, I have listened in aghast at the persons in this House casting shade on one Guyana, saying it is one for one Guyanese for one ethnic group. It is for the PVPC. The depth of mental and intellectual depravity of someone saying that is hard to conceive of. I cannot conceive of anybody taking a phrase of one Guyana and turning it upside down into this level of madness. It's a level of insanity on the other side of this House to talk about the ethnicized one Guyana. Do you comprehend how contradictory that is? Do you comprehend? Mr. Speaker, again, they're isolated. They're all alone, just like they were. Between March and August 2020, they were alone. They're again alone. The people of this country want a one Guyana. The youth of this country want a one Guyana. And yet, as I said, the opposition members seem to be devoid of understanding this concept as a pathway to build unity and a harmonious society. Maybe, you see, the catchphrase is, you gotta work. If we want to build a harmonious society, we have to work at it. We have to work at it. Maybe, Mr. Speaker, this can be explained by the 2018 PNC Region 4 District Conference at Congress Place, where the then chairman of the PNC may declare that her priority is to give jobs to her friends, who are evidently party supporters. The quote that was in the Demerara Waves of November 28, 2018 says, "The only friends I got is the PNC. So the only people I can give work to is the PNC. And right now I'm looking for a doctor who can talk Spanish or Portuguese, and I want one that is PNC." That was said by the former chairman of the PNC, Mrs. Valda Lawrence, who, by the way, is before the court as well. The PNC, as a political party, has consistently put our country on the map for the last 65 years for ethnic violence in the 60s, for rigged elections over 28 years, for selling large tracts of lands to the people called Jonestown Cult, where 900 people were murdered. And we were on the world map until 2001 for the largest number of people killed in a non-war situation. For the assassination of Walter Rodney, for the most violent crime wave in this country's history, and the longest wait for an election after a no confidence motion. We have reached global notoriety for after no confidence motion, waiting 14 months for an election. And then again, PNC wasn't satisfied with that. We have reached global notoriety for having had the longest wait after an election to have the declaration of the results. Mr. Speaker, we were on the precipice of a dictatorship, and we were resilient. And Mr. Schuman is right, what he reminded of this morning. Mr. Speaker, I'm not telling lies. This is the legacy of the People's National Congress, People's National Congress Reform, APNU AFC Coalition, and any other name they come up with. The PNC, with whatever name, has been consistently anti-national, anti-patriotic. Its stance has been, if they're not in government, nothing must work. If they're in government, still nothing works. But Mr. Speaker, when they're out of government, obstructionism is the name of the game. They must make sure to try to destabilize and destroy things. And as the earlier speaker said, my colleague Colin Crowell, not this time. It ain't happening this time. Ironically, Mr. Speaker, it is the PPP each time in government, pre-colonial and post-independence, that has taken Guyana forward, never backwards. Always the PPC has had to rescue our country from the abyss of economic decline and brought in progressive, pro-growth, pro-poor policies and programs. By 1964, Mr. Speaker, Guyana was one of the fastest growing countries in the Commonwealth. By 1992, we were the third poorest in this hemisphere. This is not guilty share of things, that World Bank and IMF. By 2014, we were climbing out of the economic abyss that was caused by the indebtedness of the PNC in the pre-92 period. And after 5 years, then they came in government in 2015. Their tax-based development approach, squandermania, anti-people policies are what dragged us down again as a country. And again, we, the PPC, are here again. And we shall this time, we ain't backing down, we shall transform our country with the oil revenues as a platform or the means to improve the quality of lives of our people, expand and diversify our economy, and transform the landscape of our nation. Mr. Speaker, I've heard a lot of people talk about the budget, and I just thought maybe it might be useful to refer to the last budget of the APNU AFC, just as a reference, so, because I've heard a lot of forked tongue speaking here. And I'm not using a curse word, Mr. Speaker. You know what a forked tongue is. APNU AFC government inherited in 2015 $780 million US dollars in foreign reserves and $13 billion in gold reserves. Mr. Speaker, what did they do with the money? Where did it go? They started out on a good wicket. The $14 million, billion dollars, was reduced to $2 billion by 2018 and $635 million in 2020. This is the Bank of Guyana statistical abstract. So they had a good getting with gold. They sold the gold at some of the lowest prices on the world market at the time. Now, if that's not stupidity, God help us. Mr. Speaker, they had international reserves, as I said, and they had also left us at the end with a small amount of approximately 528 million in 2019. So, Mr. Speaker, they had money that they used. In fact, they had money of $780 million. They dropped our reserves to the lowest they have been in years and years and years, foreign reserves. Mr. Speaker, this is an issue of not only fiscal mismanagement, because it is difficult for a country and the government of the former government of this country to have mismanaged to such levels of proportions that one wonders what and how were they governing this country. The total assets after the national no confidence motion, there was a decline of $3 billion in the total assets held by the Bank of Ghana from $220 billion in 2018 to $217 billion in September 2019. That's what we took over. Mr. Speaker, the issue of the overdraft at the bank, these are all data supported by the Bank of Ghana and its own statistics. Mr. Speaker, as I said, they were dipping into our foreign currency reserves and thereby putting us at greater risk from external and internal shocks. The IMF warned you over and over again, don't do it, stop it. But you know, APNOE FC, they don't listen to anybody. They never have and they never will. And so after the no confidence motion, Mr. Speaker, they then came and continued to give away state assets and spend money as if there was no tomorrow, as if they were still legitimately in government, although the Caribbean Court of Justice had said that they were caretaker government. Mr. Speaker, it is when I said this country, this APNOE FC is anti-national, is that look what they did with a Myler. It is now 2022. If a Myler had been gone through in 2014, we would be enjoying cheap, affordable, reliable electricity. Do you have any concept of what that would mean for this country, for the manufacturing, for the people that purchasing power, the cost of running business? Do you have any idea of this? And yet, you sat there and smashed a project that even after we left government and the Norwegian independent company came and told you, it is the most viable, ready hydropower project in the entire country. You smashed it down and left it. This is a level of anti-nationalism unheard of. Mr. Speaker, they brought 200 new taxes in. And so, what does this mean? I hear people talking about Guyanese people suffering. Mr. Speaker, approximately based on the 2019, the tax revenue, the impact of collecting $25 billion more in tax revenue, what did it mean to the families? Each family of Guyana was paying an additional $152,000 in taxes in 2019 when compared to 2018. Mr. Speaker, in 2018, we'd already seen increased prices of food, clothing, medical and personal care by approximately 4.6, 4.3 and 4%. And Mr. Speaker, if they don't believe me, they can check Appendix G of the 2019 Budget Estimates Volume 1, which shows that the Minister of Finance actually expected a reduction in private consumption in 2019, pre-COVID-19, by approximately $10 billion. In other words, people didn't have money to spend. The purchasing power of our people on average was reduced to by 462,000 less at the household level. And given, and why was this? You dismissed 7,000 people, you dismissed 2,000 community service officers, you, by your foolish policies and taxation, led to 30,000 people being unemployed. And there are again figures and surveys to show what I'm saying is correct. Mr. Speaker, this APNOE FC comes to this house, as I said, and they're immoral. They have no conscience. to talk about these issues when the facts and the documents show what was going on in this country by 2019 on the eve of the elections and after the no confidence motion. Mr. Speaker, all indicators in 2018 pointed to an economy that was deteriorating and required urgent counter-cyclical policies. Instead, Budget 2019 projected increases in tax collection, further burdening the people of Guyana, and proposed to collect tax collection by $31 billion more than in 2018. This represented an $88 billion increase in tax collection per annum based on the 2014 levels. More taxes and no moves to cut down on the extravagant, wasteful spending on things that did not bring benefit to our people. You see, Mr. Speaker, there's a fundamental philosophical and ideological difference between the PNC and its coalition partners as to how to develop Guyana. And there's a difference with us in this side of the house. Theirs is based on a tax-based, consumer-driven expenditure with party paramountcy and ethnic division and opportunistic, cavalier use of the Constitution. And let me remind you, I hear Mr. Honorable Mr. Ford talking about Constitution. In 2020, February 27th, the Starbuck News had a letter to the editor by Christopher Ram. He says the following. In fact, from the first year of his election as president, Granger set about violating his oath, bending the Constitution to his personal, previously unsuspected agenda. It was only the alertness of a few lawyers and the astuteness of the courts that the Constitution and rule of law have not so far been rendered completely useless, meaningless. The case has numbered more than three dozen. That number has no parallel in Guyana, or indeed in any country of the Caribbean, of constitutional violations by an executive or head of state, end quote. Mr. Speaker, I've heard about corruption here. We have witnessed scandal after scandal in which some former members are now before the courts for misappropriating the patrimony of the Guyanese people. Mr. Speaker, we mustn't forget the $30 billion loan they took for Gaisuko, of which they took out $15 billion, gave Gaisuko about $8 billion, and the rest cannot be explained. What happened to the $30 billion loan that you took out under very strange circumstances? But, Mr. Speaker, I am not going to go on. I just leave these as facts. 2016, Auditor General's report. 2017, Auditor Christmas General report. Right, these are all different volumes. So this is 2017, Auditor General report. Sorry, Mr. Speaker, I can't reach far enough. We have here the Auditor General report for 2018. We have the Auditor General report for 2019. We have here, these are the Auditor General report for 2020 coming up, of which you were in office for 8 months of that. All of these, every single of these reports are witness and indicators and demonstrate what you did when you were in office. Demerara Harbor Bridge, the asphalt plant, the ways, the, what you call the scales, is that what, Bishop? The issue of $800 million can't be accounted for the Ministry of Armenian Affairs. Mr. Speaker, on and on. The $600 million worth of drugs bought from a company when the NTPTAB said they did not have the waiver to get single sourcing. Mr. Speaker, I don't have time to go into all this. These 2016 to 2020 audit report is an interesting reading to see how a government refused to obey the Procurement Act of this country and violated over and over and fiscal transactions in this country. In contrast, Mr. Speaker, the PPP is one, our philosophy is one of pro-growth and pro-poor, people-centered development agenda with a climate resilient policy of an expanded local carbon development strategy, rule of law, and One Guyana. Mr. Speaker, let me just give a light moment before I go into maybe some heavier stuff before I conclude. One is that I heard people talk about poverty. Now, I'm not good at cars. I never get cars right. I never get the license plates right. I'm known to be walking into the wrong car just because it's the same color of a car I am. I have no interest in cars. However, remember in 20, the UPNOAFC brought all sorts of restrictions on purchasing of cars. Couldn't have 8 years. You couldn't buy used tires, etc., etc., and they put taxes. Since Minister of Finance and this government restored the taxes of the 2006-2008, let us look at what's happened. PAB series was finished in 7 months.
Wow.
Following.
Wow.
7 months!
That
9,999 cars were sold in 7 months, bought in 7 months. By the removal of the APNU stranglehold by tax on people. And now we're starting PAC in 7 months. If that is not an indicator, social and economic indicator of this breathing of freedom to do things that you held us down, like if you're suffocating the people in this country all the 5 years. Mr. Speaker, this government has a different style of government. Our ministers are visible, accessible across the communities in the country. And I want to say about the region I represent as a geographic MP. I went there for 3 years before. And ministers, some of them arrived, some ministers. So Upper Mazaruni never even saw a minister. Not even the one that sit, was former minister sitting over there. We'd go to Kamarang and walk to Shivillage, go to Shisha Village and come back. No meetings, no communication. Upper Maz, no minister went in. No minister in Middle Mazaruni. Minister go to Bartika and go to the hotel there, what do you call it? Arawai, and then fly off. No meetings with the people, no walkabout with the people to see what their problems were. They abandoned Region 7 because they thought Region 7 was their property, their entitlement. But let me tell you, we almost win. We're going to win. 2025, we're coming back to win Region 7. You all think it's an entitlement? The PPC, since coming to office, has been fixing the damage done by the 5 years of the PNC-led APNU-AFC coalition government in the 2020 and 2021 budgets. It is time now to transform Guyana. It is not business as usual, Mr. Speaker. The PP has managed to increase spending from $69 billion in capital in 2019 to $103 billion in 2020. And some of our friends on the other side quite don't understand what that means. Mr. Speaker, we have a golden opportunity. We have gone through so many interesting, challenging, and traumatic times as a nation since independence. This is the one golden opportunity for Guyana. It is our golden, it's our moment. And we must grasp it, we must seize it. It doesn't always come. Oil won't last here forever. And we're not going to go down the road you went of a monoculture. That's why I said, when the honorable member says about this petroleum dictatorship, I had to say, you're looking in the mirror. Because you dismantled agriculture, you had no time for any other industry except petroleum. And even then, you weren't prepared for that. But Mr. Speaker, and even the Caribbean Development Bank yesterday that approved the Linden Mabura Road said, and this was said by the CDB's president, Dr. Leon, irrespective of how much Guyana has now, the oil and gas will deplete at some point. And therefore, Guyana should be prioritizing efforts geared at sustaining development in the country. And infrastructural development, Mr. Leon believes, is a crucial component of facilitating this. Mr. Speaker, this road, the Linden Mabura, is a corridor. It's expected to facilitate a massive increase in trade with Guyana and with our bordering members in Brazil. We have to move out of this suffocation, Mr. Speaker, of always being held back by this small-mindedness, this narrow-mindedness. Our people want to dream. You want to see a Guyana with roads and highways and bridges. of jobs, of houses that can match any other country in the Caribbean and South America and even in Canada. Why mustn't we dream that? Why mustn't we believe we could do it? Why don't we believe that? Mr. Speaker, this is a golden opportunity. And basically, we have the opportunity with the oil revenues. The budget, if my maths is right, is 592 billion. And the money that we took from the natural resource is approximately 126 billion. So still, the rest of the money isn't all natural resource, is not all from oil. A large chunk of it. And that money allows us to do things we could not have done a year ago. We could not have done 10 years ago. Because you didn't have the money, the fiscal space, as Mr. Jordan would have said.
Honourable Minister, you will need to get more time to deal with the rest of the issues.
Mr. Speaker,
I seek an extra 5 minutes for Honourable Gainsey here to conclude her presentation.
Thank you, Honourable Prime Minister. Honourable Minister, you have 5 minutes to continue and to conclude.
As the Vice President, Dr. Jack Lewis said in the first interview yesterday, yes, Honourable Vice President, thank you, that he stated while current spending has increased, capital spending will grow to 218 billion, 110% increase of the 552.9 billion budget this year. This, he said, that is us building our future. Us building a future. That's where we're spending our money, investing in the things that the country will be able to feel and touch. Not all the spending will be had on things that just disappear. Mr. Speaker, there are overarching challenges we have to face to address as a nation. And we have to deal with climate change. We're a country that is a zero carbon emitter, but we also have gas. We also have to deal with the reality of our environment and climate change. We have to learn to balance all our needs and our priorities and still protect the environment. Mr. Speaker, the overarching challenges, climate change, energy, reliable, affordable energy. This was spoken to by a number of members. Third issue, Mr. Speaker, communication, which includes transportation, ICT, connectivity, communication, whether by road, by plane, by water, all of it, all the areas that can connect our country, not just with technology, but with human movement, with goods movement and investment. And the fourth one is probably the most difficult one of all, Mr. Speaker, and that's the issue of trust and confidence at the political level. And this will be determined by a number of things. We know that the people of Guyana will trust those who deliver. And so we have a pact. We have a social pact with the people of Guyana, not only those who voted for us, all the people of Guyana, that we will deliver. We have a document, our manifesto, and we have committed. And we're not 14 months later saying, we're going to do more studies. We're going to do more studies. No, Mr. Speaker, we're on the round and people are seeing physically in front of their eyes, things changing of roads and bridges and houses and water and electricity. And you can go as far as you want into the interior. You're seeing. And so the pact we have, the social contract we will have with the people is one that is built on trust and confidence. And we intend to honor that pact by delivering a Guyana that is transformed. We have to also work on having resilient and effective democratic institutions that will uphold the Constitution as part of the governance architecture of our nation. Budget 22 puts us on the path to addressing these with clear-cut priorities, programs, and projects to do so. Mr. Speaker, the country is alive. There is an energy and vitality in the country that is palpable. Guyana is back on track. To choose to quote from Dave Martin, one of the songs he brought out in 1992, Guyana is back on track. Guyana's on the move and there's nothing stopping us now to achieve the transformation of our country. Those who wish to remain narrow-minded, small-minded, will be left behind. But our people want development, they want water, reliable and affordable electricity, clean and safe houses and communities. Mr. Speaker, they want to see Guyana go forward. They're tired. They're tired of being held back. That every time there's something positive happens, there's somebody coming along and naysaying it, putting shade on it. They're tired of that. They want to move forward. And so the opposition has a choice. Join the whole process of transforming our country or be left out in the woodworks by yourself. Because history will judge you. History has judged you already for your role in the 60s, 70s, 80s, 90s, and in 2020. So you now have a chance to clear your conscience and to join the transformative agenda of Guyana. If you don't, really, I won't lose sleep of it personally, because I know that we in the PPC will continue to do what the people want us to do. They want this country to move forward. Mr. Speaker, I am a firm believer. I have great faith in the people of our country. We are resilient people. We have showed our resilience with floods, with rigged elections, and the greatest challenge and test we had, the litmus test we had, was in 2020, with the post-2020 elections. Mr. Speaker, the lost 28 years of 28 to 92 are over. The lost 5 years of 2015 to 2020 are over. We can breathe. As a people, we can transform this nation to be the Singapore or the Dubai model of the Caribbean region. Mr. Speaker, can you imagine that we in Guyana may, not in far future, sit as one of the members of OPEC? Could we have thought about that several years ago? I doubt that. Mr. Speaker, Guyana has arrived. As we say in Creole, we have arrived. And now it's time to take our rightful place globally, regionally, and most of all, to show our people that we can move this country forward. We can be proud, dignified Guyanese, and not to hold our head in shame like we were forced to in the 70s, 80s, when we went to the immigration offices in other neighboring countries where we were treated like second-class citizens. We are not second-class citizens. We are proud, and we have a lot of work to do as a nation. If the opposition wants to join, welcome. If you don't, sorry, we've got work to do. And the rest of the nation's watching you. The rest of the people are watching you, and they will join. Mr. Speaker, they have a choice to go down into the dustbin or to be part of the partnership to transform our nation. Budget 2022, Mr. Speaker, lays the foundation for the transformation of our nation. Will there be many challenges on the way, Mr. Speaker? Yes. There will be many, many challenges. But we on this side of the House, and we, the Guyanese people, have the will to make this happen. And we shall do it. Thank you very much, sir.